Is Donald Trump a fascist? Yes. Okay. Let me just further elaborate, just for the sake of making an actual video broadcast. The question has not just been one of those things that I've tossed out there, or Marxists have tossed out there. This is actually a legitimate claim that has been made from everyone from liberals to even libertarians. It's actually a common trend where people have actually been comparing Donald Trump to Adolf Hitler and the current state of his supporters to the Nazi regime. There's a lot of things that go into play about this. Just the way in general that Donald Trump speaks, the way that he the inane sense of this weird inane sense of charisma, pretty much the I don't care attitude, the overwhelming sense of confidence to basically go out there and basically not give a fuck what people think of you. Those are the good qualities that I can basically throw in there. What I really want to get to, though, is the fact that what Donald Trump actually stands for is this blatant xenophobia, homophobia, and Islamophobia. The man is, let's first break down the fact the man is a known xenophobe. I mean, the fact that he wants to basically throw out 11 to 12 million people out of this country and, frankly, not even really have a sound plan of who's an immigrant and who's legal and who's illegal. No sound plan of actually really caring about the lives that it's actually going to rip apart, the disastrous effects it'll have on certain states' economy, California. The fact that he just doesn't seem to understand the fact that sometimes immigration is actually a good thing, and actually again plays into the roles of certain states' economies, California. So it's one of those things where I kind of think that his whole fact of that he seems to target primarily Latinos and not really concerned about, you know, European immigration. He's not really concerned about Canadians coming into the country. I mean, personally, if I could stop Justin Bieber from coming into the country, I'd personally love that. But he's not concerned as much with, you know, Asians coming into the country. He's primarily concerned with mainly just Latinos. I mean, I'm sure there's, you know, he's concerned about Filipino Americans and Indian Americans and, you know, Arabs. But he doesn't really seem to really focus on, for the sake of argument, the lighter-skinned people. You know, he doesn't really seem to focus on those types of immigrations. He seems primarily focused on, you know, building the wall on the southern border. He seems pretty, you know, keen on discriminating against Latinos. He's also very, you know, he's also comes off as very a white supremacist, or at least third positionist, on a social policy concerning African Americans. even going so far as to make basically, you know, some pretty borderline racial statements, and not even, and basically suggesting that, you know, there's absolutely nothing wrong with the police force, and that the police are simply, you know, just doing their jobs. Well, that's not necessarily the case. I mean, when you actually have certain senators and certain presidential candidates that are even pointing out that we need criminal justice reform, governors pointing out we need criminal justice reform, state legislators that are, and even state legislatures saying that we need criminal justice reform, and even states themselves going to great lengths to improve criminal justice reform. But apparently the law enforcement is just doing their job, and all these people are doing is basically making it harder for law enforcement to do their jobs. No, they're basically making it better for them to do their jobs, making sure that they're doing things within the confines of bourgeois legalism, and basically going about it in all the right ways. Because, you know, they're supposed to be doing things within the confines of state and federal law, including this little thing called constitutionalism. You know, the constitutionalism, the idea of sticking by the laws of the Constitution. You know, maybe something that Donald Trump and his supporters overlook. But, you know, unless, of course, you know, you don't care about the Constitution, do you? I mean, do you care about the Constitution? In fact, and I pose that question to Donald Trump and his supporters. Do you actually care about the Constitution? You know, the founding document of America? Do you not like America? Because, you know, with the same logic you give everybody else, get the fuck out of my country. Doesn't feel so good when you're on the other end of that, does it? You know, again, just a little thing to throw out there. It's this whole idea that he comes off as blatantly third positionist in his social policy, and he comes off blatantly third positionist in his own economic policy. Now, of course, people will ask me, well, what is third positionism? Well, third positionism is basically is a socioeconomic policy, very typically far right, that advocates a very statist-controlled sort of system. In that sense, a third positionist ideology typically tends to follow a very ultra-nationalistic line. It tends to follow a very corporatocratic line, or corporatist line, and in general just typically tends to follow what we would innately call fascism. That is why the policies of Adolf Hitler, the policies of Mussolini, the policies of Front National in France, which apparently a few people that I've come in contact with seem to think is the savior of France. I don't understand that retardation, but okay. It's basically these policies are fascist. They're far-right belief systems. Now, exactly what makes Donald Trump's economic policy third positionist or fascist, or corporatist in general? Well, the fact that Donald Trump essentially wants to privatize everything and essentially run everything like it's a business. I also remind you that, you know, he's went bankrupt 4 times running a business. And the fact that he essentially just wants to run everything as if it's a goddamn corporation. Now, keep in mind, also, one of these things that he wants to basically run as a private institution is Social Security. Forgive me, but there's a reason I think it's called Social Security, because it's supposed to be a socialized, you know, thing where people who've worked really hard all their life, who've worked and put money and had that money taken out of their checks every month for 20, 30, 40 fucking years so that they have a nice little nest egg to retire on, you know, and help pay their healthcare costs in their elderly age. You know, that's supposed to be for everybody, not put into the hands of an elitist group of idiots who are going to basically say, you know, that you get this much and you know, and other people get more, or you basically, you know, don't deserve it and blah, blah, blah. No, that's not how social security is supposed to work. That's not how socialized distribution of wealth is supposed to work. And of course, people hear socialized and think, well, socialism, it's such a horrible thing. And no, it's not even necessarily a socialist policy. It's more, if anything, just a reformist policy. It's essentially, it's just the right thing to do. It's the fact that you're basically giving everybody who's put into this their whole damn lives actually has something to goddamn fucking retire on. You know, it's not something you can just take away from people and decide that they get this and other people get this, or you don't get jack shit. That's not how it works. That's not how Social Security was supposed to work. That's not how FDR intended it. You know, so the fact that you're wanting to privatize this institution is ludicrous, it's ridiculous, and it's third positionist. It's a complete detriment to anybody who's put into it. It's a detriment to the people that, like, for instance, my uncle, who served 3 branches of the U.S. military, who is a veteran, who loves his country, who's a Christian, who's conservative, who's worked his butt off and put his ass on the line for this country, and basically to tell him at the end of all this that he doesn't deserve a dime of what he earned, you don't think that's a slap in the face to him and the people that actually, you know, served this country? Are people that have actually worked their ass off? You know, that's what I'm really trying to get to, and that's why, you know, Donald Trump and his economic policy on that is very flawed, and it's very, it basically is completely centered towards the statist system. Now, let's also kind of keep in mind the fact that his economic policy is just essentially down the board completely ludicrous. The fact that you want to run every institution from education to the prisons to Social Security to everything to even the media, which practically is already there anyway, but you want to run everything like it's a state, basically as a state-owned institution. That's not how that's supposed to work. That's a complete and utter BS sort of thing. You know, it's basically just a consolidation of power is all it is. And of course, but then again, that's what corporatism is. It's basically a merger of state and corporate power. That's what fascism is. It's essentially a system based on consolidation of power and the ideals of ultranationalism, this sort of national conservatism, national traditionalism, and this idea of putting all power into one, you know, strong leader. And that's not how it's supposed to work. And basically consolidating all this power into the hands of this one bozo. That's not how shit's supposed to work. And that is exactly what makes it fascist, is the fact that this man wants to basically consolidate power. Whole life been spent on. It's being invested in wealth and power. If he's not in control, then he basically, you know, begins bitching and whining about, you know, and trying to find ways of basically having all that attention put on him. That is exactly why Trump is, in my opinion, quite legitimately the 21st century version of Adolf Hitler, every way that he's going about things and his rise to get, you know, for the conquest of power is almost exactly matched to that of Hitler. And the way that his supporters act, the way that the GOP acts in trying to support him, really is no different than that of Nazi Germany and the rise of the Nazi Party. I mean, the very nature that of Americans going towards this American traditionalist line, this American nationalist line, this ultra sense of patriotism and nationalism, this sense of, you know, overwhelming Islamophobia that comes from people, and the anti-immigration, you know, sort of sentiment that comes towards all that, even down to the Police Lives Matter idiots and the people that legitimately go out saying that African Americans are not oppressed, that they're you know, just whining about the system whenever they break the law, and that's simply not the case. So basically, these people that go out that are leaning towards Donald Trump's way of thinking, or these people that are thinking about voting for Donald Trump because they fall, you know, they, America has gone down this line, really leads to this whole idea that the Western world is literally falling to fascism. I mean, with the attacks in Paris, we've seen an ultra, we've seen ultra-nationalism and Islamophobia and xenophobia rise. We are seeing the fact that 1 in 4 French people are now considering voting for Front National in this coming election. We're seeing the rise of groups like Golden Dawn in Greece and the potential for Golden Dawn to gain power. We are seeing the rise of these ultra-nationalist groups, even though they completely flopped in this last election, but the fact that groups like UKIP exist in England, and the fact that we have this rise, this higher level and rise in Holocaust deniers and neo-Nazism in places like Germany, France, Italy, Poland, even the fucking Ukraine. That we're seeing a rise in ultranationalism in Russia. We're seeing a rise in ultranationalism in Japan. And now we see this very plague, if you will, this virus that's literally creeping into the minds of Americans and into the American political system. That is why I say the Western world, or at least the industrialized world, the first world, is falling to fascism. Lenin warned us about this. Fascism is capitalism in decay. And what are we saying? Ever since the recession that went on, the global collapse of capitalism in 2008, we have been seeing this tide turning of people that are literally giving up on essentially what is this regulated bourgeois democracy that capitalism, you know, that they try to dress capitalism up to be. And we are literally seeing people not give a fuck, to the point where people are literally turning their attention away from their own political system. And this has actually been something that is scarily becoming less and less of a real thing of Americans getting involved in, and that is politics itself. With people actually wanting less involvement with political and social, basically with the affairs of state, and they're literally willing to turn their will and their lives, the very country itself, over to the leadership of one person, over to the leadership of this this third positionist sort of thinking. This is exactly what the people in Germany did during the 1920s and the early 1930s. This is what led to the rise of Adolf Hitler. And yet, people are fully willing to go forward and let history repeat itself in electing Donald Trump as president. You don't think that that's going to be a bad idea that's going to bite us in the ass? The fact that the man has called for a ban on Muslims, not just Muslims itself, not just the ban on that, but the ban on people from Muslim countries, people that may not even identify with Islam, people that just happen to be in a country that's dominated by Islam. You know how, like, America's dominated by Christianity. And they're basically being hypocrites and saying, oh, yeah, we're going to just ban... You know, Donald Trump says, yeah, we want to just ban all people coming in from Muslim countries. Which means that a friend of mine who would like to visit here and even possibly go to school here would be denied access because of some moron who says, oh no, you come from a Muslim country, so bugger off. When she doesn't even really identify, I guess if you will, as necessarily as being Muslim. Though she does come from a Muslim family and a Muslim country, she's more agnostic, if you will. And let's be honest, in certain Muslim countries that you would identify them as, there's probably growing numbers of atheists that are living there. And yet you want to bar them from coming into this country? You want to alienate more people? You want to actually contribute to the radicalization of people? Then yeah, banning Muslims is a wonderful idea. But then again, that sort of third positionist thinking doesn't comprehend these ideals. So, the fact that you want to deny an entire group of people, discriminate against an entire group of people based upon their religion, because of what a few stupid nuts did, is really freaking ignorant and shows a lot of blatant Islamophobia and blatant xenophobia and a blatant show of fascism. I mean, what's next? I said this in a previous video. What's next? Are you going to basically start killing people who in this country who identify as Muslim? Are you going to start killing political dissidents who don't agree with your policy? Or trying to exile people? Because, you know, you're trying to hold on to your power? It's... Not only that, again, I bring up this idea of constitutionalism. That, one, you're violating the First Amendment rights of people that, you know, have the right to expressly, to express their religious beliefs and practice their religious beliefs openly. You are discriminating against them, and you're violating the 14th Amendment, which basically states that anybody that's not only born or naturalized, but anyone under the jurisdiction of the United States has a right to their freedoms. Which means that someone who comes here to visit, like we would when we go to another country, are bound to the laws of that country. So if a person comes over to this country, they're bound by the laws of our country. Am I not correct on that? Thusly, they're under our jurisdiction. They have the right to practice their beliefs. So what I'm getting at is the fact that your discrimination against a certain group of people for the fear that one, you know, lone nut might slip by is completely ridiculous. I mean, with that same thinking, why not, you know, take the guns away from white Christian males because on the off chance that one of them might be a white supremacist Christian fundamentalist twat nugget, you know, who goes and shoots up a theater in Carolina, or a theater in Louisiana, or Planned Parenthood in Colorado Springs. You know, it's one of those things where you have to really take into account what your actual policy is, what your actual priorities are, the morality of each of these things, and ultimately making sure you're not a flaming hypocrite, which in this case Donald Trump is, and his supporters are, and basically anybody that ignores the fact that we've had twice as many freaking killings by white Christian males in this country than we have people that have been killed by Islamic extremism. Oh, but of course that's just liberal propaganda. Yeah, the liberal propaganda thing. That's another thing that I hear coming out of the mouths of conservatives who basically deny the facts when the facts have been presented to them. And then back up nothing. They literally come back backing up nothing in saying, no, it's liberal propaganda. That's false information. That's all just made up by the liberal media. It's, then where's your facts? Because at least I present a actual source that legitimately comes from a study, but you're just wanting to easily dismiss it on, because what reasons, or just because of your blatant ideology. Well, I'm sorry, your personal beliefs and your ideology don't mean jack diddly unless you actually provide something that discredits me. And the fact that you literally are trying to say that, oh no, you know, Muslims kill, are, you know, are such evil people, they kill all this, it's not a religion of peace, it's, well, neither is Christianity. And to those Jeb Bush idiots who basically say there's no such thing as radicalized Christianity, you don't know your fucking Christian history, and you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Keep that in mind. Just because you don't like somebody's religion does not mean your religion is not susceptible to radicals, to radicals within it. Christianity has just as many radicals as Islam does. And both of them claim to be a religion of peace. But if you actually read the Bible and the Quran, they actually pretty much say the same thing and mention the same people. And frankly, Mary Magdalene is actually mentioned more times in the Quran than the Bible. And if you actually read up on a lot of the different things that go on there, both of them advocate some pretty good things and teach some pretty good things. Other things, it's just like, what the fuck? Things like basically killing people in the name of conversion towards that religion. And I want to reiterate that Christianity has done that more than Islam has. In case you don't want to believe that, I suggest you read up on the Seven Crusades, because that's a perfect example of Christian terrorism right there. Also the burning of witches and heretics, and basically the persecution of Jews during the Black Plague. And yeah, I literally could go on about the atrocities committed under Christianity that I would say almost vastly outnumber the amount of killings that radical Islam has done, or that Islam in general has done. So it's one of those things, we could go tit for tat on that all day long. And frankly, I'm not willing right now to have that discussion on that, because right now all that bullshit is trivial compared to what I'm actually trying to talk about. Essentially, getting back to what I'm talking about is the fact that Donald, if you actually look at everything right down the line, Donald Trump is advocating fascism. At least on the ideal, on a social and economic scale, they are third positionist. We can say that at the very least fact. And the fact that he advocates this third positionist line, the fact that the man is an ardent xenophobe, a blatant Islamophobe, and a pretty good candidate for a racist, all kind of pretty much to me goes into this whole thing of Adolf Hitler being the same thing, except instead of being an anti-Semite, Donald Trump is basically anti-Islam. Now, of course, there was one person I was chatting to in a comment section who brought up Jimmy Carter. And I want to address that before anybody tries to bring that up or call me a hypocrite. It's the fact there's a slight difference between the way Donald Trump is handling this and what Jimmy Carter went about. Jimmy Carter essentially was, and this is over Iran, Jimmy Carter was reacting in more of a stereotypical, I would say stereotypical, liberal imperialist way. He basically was acting in the way of essentially the leader of the hegemonic power, the United States, would on basically a nation that does not hold that much power. Essentially, the fact that the United States was not too happy over the fact that its puppet government that under the Shah was overthrown in 1979 by the Islamic Revolution. Now, if we actually look at the clerics and the Ayatollah and, you know, a lot of your older and more conservative members of that and the people that were more involved in that, like students during that time who now are getting up into their, you know, middle-aged and, you know, older years, these people were, by definition, they were ultra-nationalists. They were very devout in their faith, so ultra-conservative. They were traditionalists. And they basically rejected the more liberal forms of, the more liberal forms of governance under the Shah. And so essentially, in 1979, they overthrew that government and instilled this essentially theocratic, quasi-democracy, this quasi-fascist sort of system in there, and basically ruled it with an iron fist up until a couple of years ago when Hassan Rouhani essentially became president of Iran. Now, the Supreme Leader, Ayatollah Khomeini, still basically has a large chokehold on that country. But he represents a very older crowd. He represents a clerical crowd, an ultra-nationalist, traditionalist sort of crowd that believes in, a very conservative form of Islam and believes that, the U.S. is out to destroy them, much like the U.S. believes that Islam is out to destroy them, and is that basically this country is a threat to Islam, just like the U.S. thinks that essentially, every other country that basically doesn't follow its regime is a threat to Christianity, is a threat to their hegemony. And so it's really one of those things where it's really kind of, he said, it's more of, they said sort of situation. What we need to understand is the fact that now in Iran, there is this new movement that is being led by people like Rouhani, who are more moderate, the younger people that are coming up in Iran, who are more liberal, who are more moderate than their predecessors, than people like Khomeini, the people that have literally, you know, actually, the people that are actually willing to negotiate and sign sorts these nuclear, you know, sort of treaties with the United States, people that actually are more willing to open up their doors to the United States. You know, there's actually is that movement that's growing. There is this sort of neoliberalism that is building in the country, and to the totalitarianism, the totalitarians that are in power, the traditionalists, they see that as a threat to them. And this is no different than basically how the GOP views young people today and views the, you know, this growing, you know, sense of neoliberalism and stuff like that as a threat to their power. And so what I want to get back to is the fact that Jimmy Carter played the role of the liberal imperialist, you know, leader of a hegemon down to the T back in 1979. His interests, you know, his country's business interests, their political interests, everything that, you know, you want to throw in there, were concentrated on keeping that puppet government in power, and it failed. But it was not the banning of the embargo on Iran, that the sanctions put on Iran and everything like that, the barring of people from Iran, wasn't necessarily a racial issue or a religious issue. It was more of just a political statement of the U.S. basically not wanting to deal with this new government that they thought was illegitimate. So it's not, there's really not a sense of xenophobia. There's not a this that racist sentiment. There's not this it wasn't about Islam or Islamophobia. It was just blatantly an act of imperialism, plain and simple. Whereas Donald Trump's actions towards what's been going on is it more of a very reactionary sentiment. It's a very reactionary sort of, you know, go-round. He's reacting to these situations, that being Paris and San Bernardino, and he's literally calling for the complete barring of people from any Muslim country. The barring of Muslims, even believing that Muslims should carry identification, you know, basically be identified, and, you know, I think even took the idea of the band, you know, on the arm, which doesn't sound at all like, you know, Hitler and the Jews. That was sarcasm, by the way. The fact that he wants to essentially focus on sending 11 million immigrants back, that he's fixated primarily on Latinos, even going so far as calling Latinos rapists and drug dealers or whatever it is, basically in calling them cartel members, you know, going so far as to call African Americans thugs and vigilantes. It all of these are outright racist, xenophobic statements. And the fact that he's lumping all these people together into one clump based upon their race or their religion is no different than what Hitler was doing in Germany when he basically said that Jews were rats and that they were what was the biggest problem with Germany, homosexuals were some threat to Germany, that communists and that's another thing, you know, the fact that, oh, these communists are such a threat, they have this such evil, delusional ideology. They are a threat to our society. And you get that sentiment also from Donald Trump, and but more from the GOP itself, but Donald Trump too. And it's all the fact that this man is just completely and utterly no real sentiment needed. And for lack of a better term, I'm just going to put it out there, the fact that this man, like Hitler, is just utterly batshit goddamn fucking insane. And yet, this is what people are actually trending towards, and that we're actually giving attention to, and all that. This man has the potential to be this country's leader. And that right there is a very scary thought. And it's not scary in the sense that I fear the man. It's scary towards the sense that people are literally letting history repeat itself. They're willing to put their will and their lives over to a dictator, over to a person that has no real leadership skills, who has not even served, you know, any sort of political fashion. And the fact that two of his wives, because I think his current wife is too, are immigrants. He himself is the son, you know, happens to be the son of an immigrant, and that fortune that he inherited is essentially based upon cronyism. And yet, this is a man that you are literally thinking about putting into power. Okay. I mean, this all, again, straight to the punch, are reasons to really be concerned. This man is blatantly third positionist. He's got a third positionist social policy, a third positionist economic policy that is essentially corporatist, and the man on these merits, on the things that I've broken down in this video, yes, Donald Trump is a fascist. To answer that question, is Donald Trump a fascist? Yes, he fucking is. I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner. Peace.